Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce this second session of our seminar on humanitarianism and human rights. As you saw yesterday in the talk of Professor Clara, there are many issues that are linked to care in terms of humanitarianism and human rights. In some aspects, they are working together. In others, there are differences, contradictions, and we have now the opportunity to hear two great colleagues and scholars. Professor Sophia Gruskin is professor of preventive medicine at Keck School of Medicine and professor of preventive medicine and law in the Gould School of Law, University of Southern California. Thank you to be here. Yes, great. And Professor Peter Redfield, professor of anthropology at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. And Professor Adriana Petrina will be the discussant of the session. So we have the two presentations, then Adriana will make some comments, and then we will open to the debate. Okay, so thank you, please.
Okay, since this is bright and early in the morning, and I was instructed not to take too much time, I thought I would show you some slides, speak informally off these slides, and try and restrict myself to about 15, 20 minutes. I'm happy to go on and on and on about any of these topics, should you wish. But I see my role today as mostly, once I figure out where we have a keyboard here, mostly trying to represent a vision of humanitarianism next to a perspective of human rights in relation to this key topic of word care. And care also reminds me, once I say that word, that I should say a thank you to Jose Ricardo and to Joao and all the people who put this together, because I'm very much looking forward to, once I'm able to sit down and listen, learning a great deal more about care and thinking more directly about care. But my starting point for this is I thought I would use a phrase that frequently floats through a good deal of discussion in global health, and especially in moments of talking about outbreak conditions and problems, and recognize that while disease may not know borders, care certainly does. There are lots and lots of borders with care. And what I mean by that is I'm thinking about a whole range of classic ways in which humans divide themselves, kin, communities, however they're constituted, and then particularly nation states, which is what I'll be focused on today, because the model for thinking about health as a right in practice primarily is associated with the provision of care as a civil right, as a citizen right, if you have a state which has the capacity to deliver that to you. Otherwise, that care as a right is frequently spoken about in the abstract and not actually made real, it's not realized, except if there is a provision of care for the suffering stranger, the figure who stands outside of community, outside of kin, and outside of nation states, which is the central figure in contemporary understandings of what humanitarianism would be. So what I want to try to do very quickly today is suggest to you something of the lineage of what the concept of the humanitarian version of care would be, as the central component, or the defining component of what humanitarianism is in the language and understanding of the aid world. It's not the only form of humanitarianism by any means, and it's one that is historically specific, but it is dominant in the media landscape of the present. To use as a case study very quickly that organization that I know best, Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, or MSF, as they're known in the aid world, as an unusual and particular, but nonetheless, I think, highly revealing example of what care on a global scale would be, what it means to be sans frontières, without borders, when you're talking about care in response to things like outbreak diseases. And so to speak about care beyond national populations, beyond, in that sense, a classic formation of biopolitics or a national healthcare plan or the terrain, which is dominant in much of the practice of lives, and I think many of the case studies also that we might be encountering today. And then finally, contrast a response to immediate needs, which is what is embodied primarily by this form of humanitarianism, versus claims to rights. So that's what I'm going to try and do very quickly. So first of all, saving lives, which is the impulse to respond to immediate needs. I just want to note with this that you can see there's a history to this phrase of saving lives. If you get asked for money, a solicitation by an organization like MSF, this is frequently the line that we'll use, that you can save lives. If you donate, you can participate, and you can achieve this goal. This has a history which is tied to religion, and it's also a history that has a particular lineage within medicine of what it would mean to practice a kind of life-saving care, which is prominent, especially in relation to emergency care, which I'll get to in a moment. So that's 1908, and then right after the First World War, you have Save the Children, which is the first major NGO of this sort, and then some brochures from MSF from the 2000s. And also very quickly, just as a reminder of the history here, there's also religious history, there's also contestation of what symbols could be used to stand in for that kind of care, which would be a care which would be an action in the name of alleviating suffering, which would stand outside of conflict. And there's the tradition of humanitarianism that MSF represents comes very much out of the Red Cross and out of warfare, out of conflict, out of a state of exception, out of a moment which is at the edge of law where you have to create another body of law, the laws of war, in order to try and tame it or civilize it or make it less deadly. And so you have the Red Cross, which may or may not exactly come from the flag of Switzerland, but the flag of Switzerland, of course, is a cross which is embedded further or deeply in history. Once it is the Red Cross, you have the Red Crescent, and then you have the problem of what to do with other symbols and whether or not they would be accepted. And so you had the Red Crystal finally in 2006 as being the alternative, because there are a few people in the world maybe attached to the crystal, but relatively few compared to people who are attached to these other symbolic images. MSF itself, in terms of being a trajectory, comes out of the Red Cross, most directly in terms of its immediate lineage, but it also comes out of emergency medicine. Emergency medicine comes out of war medicine, and the concept of saving lives, of reanimating lives in an emergency sense, Michael Nurok has some nice stuff on this in terms of looking at the end of the 19th century, what it means to be able to bring back to life, is not that old in terms of the history of medical care. It's relatively recent. And the whole notion of having an ambulance for civilians is also not that old, late 19th century, early 20th century. And the notion of having an emergency department or specialty of emergency medicine is not that old. It's primarily post-World War II is really where you get it as being a defining practice. And in the French context, which is where MSF first came, it's really the 1960s. It's right in the period immediately before the formation of this organization that the establishment of emergency care for civilians becomes a norm for civilian society in France. And what MSF represents at a certain technical level medically is the extension of that globally, that of Sans Frontières, you will provide a kind of an ambulance on a global scale. And by emergency and medical terms, to me this has always captured it quite well, is talking about those things where the temporality matters. In a phrase from MSF's fundraising, speed saves lives. If you're there quickly, the patient doesn't bleed out. If it's a kind of disease that moves quickly, if you respond in a rapid manner, it will make a huge difference than if you respond slowly. Of course, many, many, many medical conditions, and indeed the majority of the work that MSF does, doesn't really fit this pattern. Nonetheless, it is central in terms of the imagery and the understanding of what an emergency would be, an emergency response. And MSF developed a whole logistics system to be able to work internationally, like globally, on this scale, and respond worldwide quite quickly. And all major entities that do have good logistics, which again, there's also a history of things coming out of the military, a formation of logistics, and then also large-scale corporations, the movements of food around the planet, there's a background history is what I'm trying to gesture to here very quickly. The other space that's very important historically for MSF and for this form of humanitarianism is the refugee camp. And again, it's another end of war displacement in the 20th century. And this is really in the 1980s, the space in which they came to operate, which defined many of their modes of engagement. It's their natural habitat, if you will. Just very quickly, as a one slide sense of this organization through time, it's a little more than four decades old. It's a true NGO. By that I mean that it derives most of its fundraising from private solicitations of citizens, not from states, whereas many NGOs are actually funded largely by grants from states or philanthropic entities. MSF is much less so. Its orientation is strongly reflected by the emergency, even if its practice is much broader, and its moral focus, again and again, will be returning to a phrase like saving lives, a notion that you can intervene, you can make a difference, and you can count it in terms of who lives and who dies, that critical point of intervention. In terms of the globe, of course, it's not the whole globe where they are working at any given moment. It's some parts more than others, and if you looked at it in terms of depth of scale and weight of enterprise, using funding as a very simple metric to do that, the heart of what is going on in the humanitarian world is in sub-Saharan Africa, just as it is for a lot of global health work. And that is a different terrain in terms of concepts such as what is a state, what is a population, what's a community, where would the borders be, and how easy or how difficult are they to cross. So in terms of thinking about precarious and care delivery, that's part of what I want to introduce to the conversation. I also want to, partly because together with Erica Bornstein, we're trying to figure out some of the terrain of humanitarianism. One of the things we did was simply begin to try and standardize and compare the annual reports of different organizations, because at that moment it was relatively difficult to do, to figure out who's big and who's little. And the main thing which I want to note is that state-to-state aid is at a still quite a different scale than most of what's going on, even with large NGOs. There are a few exceptions, like World Vision is quite large. And then also the Partners in Health, which anthropologists like to talk about very much, is on this scale quite small. It's not very large. After the Haiti earthquake, they grew quite a bit, but they're not on the same order as some of these other entities, which are older, more established. They're also not an emergency organization. They have a different mode of engaging, even if they respond in emergency fashion. And then also politically, I always want to recall that as well as action in the name of care, there are other kinds of actions, and there are other kinds of interests, and there are other flows of funds, and some of them are at a completely different scale altogether, compared to the work of health and the work of care. If you're relying on the media or you're focused on emergency, there is a problem of the movement of crisis, that crises have a relatively short lifespan in terms of the degree to which they receive attention. And while the problem may not fade, the attention fades, the cameras move, everything proceeds. And there's a whole problem also with organizations like MSF, the pathos, and also the practical issue with them in terms of the experience any population will have of them is that they come and they go. Even when they're there over a long time, they will be there repeatedly with different projects. And so it does not work very well in terms of thinking about a plan or in terms of thinking about a real system for care delivery. What I'm trying to emphasize is that humanitarianism is no solution to long-term problems of health. And the people involved in this know it. But nonetheless, this is the mode and this is the form of engagement in the name of saving lives in the immediate present, in the moment of the problem, is their response. This is one or two cartoons I'll show you, are internal cartoons from MSF, which are, of course, humor is a place where anxieties get expressed. And so this is the anxiety of movement, of how the sense they understand how deeply they are tied, and much of their work is tied to the media and the relatively short attention span globally. By the way, I saw one infographic, I forgot to put it in this, but apparently the attention span of the average American, according to some psychologists who are testing this, is now shorter than a goldfish. If you look at them in comparison, it's we're now below 9 seconds, so it's a measure there. And then this is the piece I want to get to in terms of talking about care and thinking about borders, which is the other key term, I think, of our era, besides health, security, and the manner in which health and security can weave together, and what that does to rights. Again, this is another internal cartoon from MSF. And in this case, it's being presented in relation to military humanitarianism. This is from the early part of the 2000s. But I thought that I would give very briefly, as a way by way of example, since it's the crisis of the moment, has been, it may already be fading in the context of the United States, but it was 24/7, there was nothing you could hear in relation to health in this country except Ebola for a period of time. That this is a perfect example for thinking about the intersection of health and security concerns. You could watch it real time unfold in front of your eyes before the camera, and MSF was front and center as a star of this particular moment. There's a whole lot more to say about it, but I'll just quickly show you a couple of things and then try and reach a point of mentioning human rights so I can pass the baton and move along. Just to note, there are all kinds of earnest infographics about Ebola, very interesting one. The New York Times has a lot of nice stuff with this. The Guardian does, NPR, you can find lots of good images which are making the case, they're trying to make the case, the emphatically obvious case that is this is both a real emergency in a particular part of the world and it's a non-emergency in other parts of the world, but that does not necessarily translate into where the focus or the attention or the discussion occurs. And even here you have the lightest color in the scale is 1 to 999 cases, which is quite a range. If you stop and think about it, it's an enormous range, and the difference between one end of that and the other end is significant. Or another kind of example, just updated as of November 10th, where you have an epidemic and where you have security anxieties, so that you can see, you can literally map them and count them, the number of cases in the US and one death for this entire media spectacle, compared to the concentration, you could not possibly have the same kind of visualization in West Africa, of course. It wouldn't show up the same way. It would just blot out that part of the map if you did it one by one. Then also, I just wanted to put this out there to think that's their care beyond need, in a sense. Not that I'm in any way against prevention or preparation or anything like that, but the number of centers, the amount of personal protective equipment and all the rest which is being distributed in the context of the United States versus what is being built and set up in West Africa. If you, sorry, I should have included a slide with that as well so you could see one for one. But to think about where, how is care distributed in relation to that being a central problem to talk about. And then also if you go online and you, I won't do this because running out of time. This is a nice sort of model sliding scale to make the point of when do you intervene and what effects does that have in terms of the temporality as it's imagined, as it's projected for this sort of outbreak disease. And so you can slide the intervention earlier or later and the curve flattens down or it goes way up. Just to make the point, the time of response can matter in this emergency moment as it's understood and perceived biomedically. So moving to human rights, this is an image from MSF South Africa, which is it's a long story there as well. And the story of MSF in South Africa is a bit different. It's a story of HIV/AIDS. It's a story of partnership. It's a story of solidarity. And then this is, in this case, it's about anti-xenophobic, opposing xenophobic violence against migrants in South Africa. And the reason I'm using this poster is because there's an assembly of this a new branch of the organization in 2011, where, as they typically do within MSF, it's part of what's very interesting about them as an organization, they had an internal debate. In this case, the topic was, should MSF endorse health as a human right or not? There was a little movement that was going on, should they be signatories or not? And the conclusion from the outset was that they would not. That was pretty clear they wouldn't, but they were going to debate it anyway, and they were going to articulate to themselves why they would not, even though there's a sense in which they are, especially in the South African context, and this would be contested in the debate, they embody a kind of effort to provide health as a human right. And so this is the place, the end of the puzzle, which I want to leave us with. And part of the answer I want to suggest to you is because MSF is constantly having it two ways. There's a sense in which they are working through a set of double binds, where they're trying to both play very nicely at certain moments and speak in kind, soothing tones to entities like pharmaceutical companies. And there are other moments where they're seeking to denounce them, to be public and to have an activist face. And they're doing both of these things, different parts of the organization at different moments in different contexts for different reasons. They're moving back and forth continually. And so there's a much longer answer, but the short answer is this is the central condition they find themselves in. They're constantly doing things that they say they're not doing or saying things that they may not be doing at the same time. And that slippage they see as actually being ethical as opposed to being a sign of moral failure. Just to note, the moments where they most closely perhaps approach human rights and human rights claims, the moments where they have spoken out, and they have an internal history series they've just made public. There's the website if you want to go read them, which is essentially all the moments that haunt them as an organization, the moments which they see as being once a great failure for humanitarianism. And this might approach part of what Clara was talking about last night in terms of thinking about mourning, in terms of thinking about loss, in terms of thinking about the other kind of care attached to death, which by and large in the project of saving lives, you don't, once they're dead, they're not a part of what you do. And MSF does not really know as an organization what to do with death, or what to do with loss, or what to do with the past. But this is a site where they're trying, in a sense, to work through certain moments of trauma. And it's one, again, which approaches human rights. So this is the place where I thought I would end, is just with this line that came from this one of the speakers at this debate, MSF South Africa, who was representing the party line and being shouted down at different moments. But this is his claim was, our job is not to cure the system, but to save lives. And this is what they will constantly return to, even as they are producing claims that countries have borders, people don't. Of course, people do, but they're implying that the right sort of people who are right-minded and thinking and responding in the name of care won't have borders, and yet stop short of proclaiming a kind of universal right to health. So I will stop there and pass the baton along.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I took quite seriously the concept of care, the idea that we were discussing care and trying to think about how human rights could be relevant or helpful to thinking about that and be helpful as an organizing principle. And so, and it was really useful, I have to say, first of all, to thank you to both of you for that, for having to kind of conceptualize around kind of thinking about what this could offer or not in terms of being able to have this conversation. And so I'm going to do a lot about thinking through kind of the implications of certain definitions, because I think that it may be relevant to the conversation that we're trying to have together. I want to start with the humans. Okay, and not just start with the concept of care, because I think we have to be really clear about who has, if we're going to try to construct a right to care, we have to think about who those people are. And I think, and the point I'm trying to make with this slide is, those people are everyone. And that many of us have overlapping identities in terms of who we are, but some of us do things where our behaviors are criminalized. We have to recognize who the humans are. And I think that when we start to talk about rights, often, particularly in the context of health, we may lose sight of the people. And so I'm trying to put the people front and center. And ideally, if I was smarter about PowerPoint, I would have images there. But I'm not as good as that, so I don't know how to do the images. I just know how to type the words. And so it's like one of those things where that's the idea, is that you should imagine that there are images of human beings there who represent all sorts of different things. Okay, so that would be that slide. And I just to say that in terms of the humans, then thinking about then, since the rubric that I was given was the right to health, what do we actually mean by the right to health? And I want to start with basically the grandmother of the right to health, which is really where it starts from, and point out that in terms of, this is the very initial definition, and I want to just look at how limited it is. I mean, whether it's the fact that it doesn't recognize sex or gender, which is kind of important, I would say, just saying. But it's that, but also, if we think about it in relationship to care, and we think about what that means ultimately in terms of care, there's a number of concepts that are embedded in here in terms of what it would take for us to be able to reach this standard of health. Who has the obligation? Who's responsible for doing that? Who's able to do this? And actually, and who benefits? But also, how much do we ourselves want whatever that vision of care is that's being imposed upon us? So I want to just kind of put that into kind of this sort of larger frame here. Now, when the right to health was actually made into a legal right that at this point 163 countries of the world, not including this one, have ratified to say that they take seriously that they have an obligation for the right to health, the one I want to point to particularly because I think it's relevant to our discussion around care is number 4, which is the creation of conditions. And the concept of conditions, and to think about what would be the conditions that are necessary to think about care. Where is health within that, and kind of, and where is the broader definition to work with? And the Committee on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights of the UN has tried to further define this in ways that I think may be helpful for the conversation. And it's an authoritative interpretation for what that means. I jump between being a legal scholar and a public health person. And so in the context of saying this, I want to be clear that this is an authoritative interpretation. But as public health people, we can work with it however we want, right? So I want to make sure that we're looking at this. So I'm giving you kind of this piece of it. And just to say that if you think about it in terms of the delivery of services, we're talking about availability, accessibility, acceptability, and quality. That's just good public health. Right? I mean, that's just good public health. But the thing is that now having it within a human rights framework gives it a legal frame around it that kind of makes it useful in terms of being able to talk about things. And clearly there we're talking about the delivery of services. And in thinking about the delivery of services, that's something that easily fits within a framework of care. But I want to open up the conversation now about underlying determinants of health. And also recognize the obligation there that exists in terms of other issues which move beyond the delivery of care, that deal with water, food, sanitation, housing, and open up the question as to how much of that in a framework of care that we think about in relationship to health do we want to include. And I open it and just kind of gonna keep going just a little bit along those lines. I bolded out the kinds of the lines here that I thought would be particularly relevant in terms of thinking about what this means for care. And the two things I want to point out in particular is you'll note in the bottom the right to health, prescribing, discrimination, and access. And I would say that in terms of thinking about health care, we need to think about what it takes for people, which is coming back to that first slide about all the humans that are there, what we mean in terms of what it takes for people to be able to access care. And I would show you also how much broader of a definition this is than the 1946 definition. But if we collectively say that we understand care in a broader way, then we need to be able to think about what it takes for people to be able to access the care that is available, not just the fact of providing it. And in order to think about that, what I would propose and what I kind of want to lay out here is that I actually think that, and I, you know, think that essentially you can't think about care by only thinking about the right to health. And so, and looking at the fact that in the invitation I was given, I was asked to think about the right to health. And so I want to broaden the conversation to think about the other rights that are also going to be quite relevant if we're going to be thinking about care, and frankly also for health, right, in terms of just being able to think about what it is that we need. And of course, and I've bolded out the right to health because of course, but I'd like to submit for conversation these other rights as well in terms of how it is that we think about what they mean, and also the framework of accountability, which is not in itself a right, but is a standard in human rights that is incredibly relevant to how we think about the work that we do. Okay, just very quickly, because I've gone on about this, I just wanted to say, look, what I'm talking about in terms of rights I am starting from this legal obligation, and I am starting from what states have agreed to amongst one another, which means that it is the floor and not the ceiling of what we want. Okay, I'm starting from that because that's the basis to work from. But again, I don't want us to be stuck there. It's more just to say that that's the opening into this in terms of being able to. I do a lot of work with governments, and it becomes really important to be able to define my terms so that it's clear when I'm talking about how it is that we think about delivering services, how it is that what I'm grounding what I'm saying is. Grounding is what I'm saying to, if, is. Okay, but anyway, what I'm grounding. And so it becomes important to be able to kind of draw on this in terms of being able to do this. And the only reason I have this slide is I just want to point out that this range of treaties has within it, depending on which countries you are from or you work in, has many of the rights that I put up there that are relevant to being able to think about health. And we can get into the United States if anybody wants later about what we haven't ratified, et cetera, but that's not the reason I'm putting it up here. But I wanted to say that there are really three ways of thinking about how it is that we operate and think about using rights. And I want to lay them out because how we think about what this means for creating a vision of care is, I think, important. The first is the advocacy approach. So for example, calling for a right to care. You notice that on my list, I didn't have that listed because at this point we don't have it yet. But that doesn't mean that we can't be calling for it. And my friend Allie Miller, who many of you may know, she talks about t-shirt rights, which is basically that, you know, it doesn't mean that it means any less, but you have it on the t-shirt and it means something. And when you were talking about MSF, and I was thinking about MSF claiming the language of the right to health, it has to be for its purposes. So it's an advocacy piece in terms of kind of what it means for the advocacy work that people are doing. There's a very different way of using it, of using rights, which again, I don't think is as relevant to our purposes here, which is about using the courts and the ways in which people will use the courts in order to make enforceable rights around care. And certainly in countries around the world, we see that. And so I want to be clear that that's not the way I'm thinking about it for this conversation, but I want to make sure that it's on the table, because if that's coming up, I think it's the only way to have clarity in terms of the discussion. And then the third way, which is the way that I think may be most relevant, is the way of thinking about what it means for programming, what it means for the work that we do, and how we work together. And here, what I would submit to you is that it's about using those rights to be able to think about what they can actually mean for how it is that we think about doing our work. And in terms of, and this is where I move into a public health person, to be able to say that it's really about how we actually apply these rights and put them into kind of the framework of care that we are looking at. And again, I too am rushing through this. I have a lot more to say about these pieces, but I just kind of want to get these concepts sort of on the table for discussion. You know, why do we do this? I mean, I think that using human rights, we have an evidence base at this point that can show that in the programming piece, and I'm very clear that I'm not in the advocacy and I'm not in the law, I'm really in terms of how we think about doing our work in public health, in global health, we now have an evidence base that shows the value of this approach in terms of how it is that by having a legal framework in place, but also the systematic application of these principles, what this can actually do to try to improve the delivery of care. And I use delivery of care in this context very much around the delivery of medical services. I want to be clear about that because it's a more narrow definition than necessarily I think where we should be. But that's where we are. I'm putting this up, I want to flash through this very quickly. We did some work for WHO on contraceptive information and services. And it occurred to me as I was putting together the slides for this that we shouldn't do the same thing. But what occurred to me was that we used a methodology that might be interesting to think about in terms of care, which is that we came up collectively with a conceptual frame. We came up with an idea collectively from all of our different disciplines about what were the rights we thought were most relevant to being able to do that. We then moved into doing systematic literature reviews around what we knew as the evidence base in each area, and out of that created a framework to be able to think about how to move this, the information and services forward. And it occurred to me that in terms of thinking about care, and if we're really moving kind of the agenda, one of the things we could think about is how do we actually take what we know from our different disciplines and move it forward. So that was the only reason to put that up. And then I just have two more slides, if I can, just to close up here. There are strengths and weaknesses to using a rights lens. And I think that all of the thing that is most important for me is that we're clear about what we mean and what rights means when we're using rights in the context of this discussion. It can have very different implications for programming, for data collection, for disaggregation, for accountability, for legal claims, but also, from my perspective, what's important is for people who are skeptical of rights, I think that the looseness of how people talk about rights can be really problematic. And it actually hurts the cause of trying to get rights better integrated into global health work, and that it's really important that we're systematic in terms of how it is that we talk about it and how we think about it. And, you know, this is kind of basically where I want to end, but I want to really kind of push on this for a bit. I think generally people would agree that a rights orientation to care means going beyond just a particular health outcome. But beyond that is where it actually gets complicated, because it focuses attention not only on what services are provided, but how they're provided, the rights principles that are in action. But it also potentially addresses the pathways and the processes towards reaching that outcome. But potentially, it goes further than that. So if you're thinking about the different disciplines that we represent in this room, is our focus really around care as it relates to what it means for the delivery of health services? Or is it care as it relates to the health and well-being of the very people that I showed at the beginning on that very first slide, just their health and well-being more generally? Or is it even beyond their health and well-being and their enjoyment of rights more generally? Because where we start from has huge impacts for how it is that we have this discussion, and also where the obligation is and who's responsible and how to think about it. And just my last slide is just to say that in terms of being able to think about this, and like I said, I was trying to raise questions and issues for us to discuss, less than kind of laying out that this is how it is. And what I think is that if we're clear about what we mean about rights, we also have to be clear about what we mean about care. And to be able to think about those pieces together, because there is an incredible potential, I think, in terms of why I was excited to have this invitation, is I think there's an incredible potential in terms of what the synergies between the public health work that's happening around care and the human rights work that's happening around care, and then what I'm hearing that other disciplines that are here are doing. And so for that, I'm grateful for the invitation, and I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you so much, Sophia and Peter, for your talks and also challenges for us to consider the prospects, limitations, and I think double binds of care delivery in a time of global health and humanitarian relief. In these areas, ethnographers have captured well, I think, the kinds of uncertainties and complex networks and human stories that are often contained in these arenas. For example, what are the ordinary transactions that make care possible, but which are highly contingent or conditional, and even sometimes highly unpredictable for patients, many of whom, as we know, enter into the patient role only episodically, if at all. So there are no quick fix solutions here. So as scholars, like Peter Redfield and Didier Fasson and others have shown, emergency response systems are specific forms of governance, triaging services and care delivery, often on the basis of strict criteria of eligibility, urgency, or perceived need. They create their own, in one of Peter's words, bio-expectations, and what he used today, borders of care. Within these forms, I've been interested in a conceptual shift in both biomedicine and global health, from a focus on a right to health, often equated with a right to medicines, to the institutional dynamics that facilitate, or I think more usually obstruct, what I think of as a right to recovery. Who has a right to medicine? And who has the right to the cure? That is, who has a right to exit from their disease? This question, I think, is painfully real today. I think we'll hear about it from Rafi, but you can see the images of the healthcare workers from Ebola-stricken lands cured. You know, they're getting the cure, whereas others aren't. So from a care perspective, what cuts through the human right to health and humanitarian logics of care is this very specific right of exiting from one's disease. So these questions about the right of exit are as true here as they are elsewhere. And they raise fundamental questions for me about what biomedical innovation is good for if it doesn't have an adequate theory and practice of care behind it. For example, in the US, until recently, mortality rates for all cancers were 12% lower among the privately insured than they were for the uninsured. So even the most advanced cancer treatment science has to offer cannot reduce the risk of death from cancer by this much. That a cure for cancer is not merely hypothetical, but a reality, but still out of reach for so many, raises questions about not only who has the right of access to medical goods and a right to health, but also about who has the right to heal from disease. What social and political arrangements optimize recovery and health, and what arrangements make this path so perilous, even fatal? My own earlier research on emergency response in the context of disaster and the kinds of highly interpersonal relationships of care and neglect that evolve from one disaster to the next link to broad questions of accountability and the forms of emergency thinking, to borrow Elaine Scarry's phrase, that foreclose possibilities of care and resolution. So not just measures of success and accountability and how they are engineered in the first place, but the political forms that emergency thinking takes. Emergency thinking, she argues, often overinvests power in centralized authorities, in this case, centralized health authorities. And this shapes specific kinds of prospects for what she calls the equality of survival. On other registers, Joao Biel, I, and Joe Amon, and Mariana Sokal, have looked into the promises and perils of a national rights-based approach to health. In Sophia's word, what it takes for people to access care and what states have agreed to. So we explore the judicialization of the right to health in Brazil, and we can think of it as a kind of proxy terrain of health access, where patients are experiencing medical attention episodically, registered in terms of medicinal legal acts, cases won, and where often powerful therapeutic misconceptions are at play. Courts in Brazil, with constitutional right to health like the majority of countries on this planet, have been inundated with citizens' legal challenges for access to a wide variety of medicines, including ones that should be in the pharmacies that are on the government lists but actually aren't in the pharmacies. So here's a shift from states deploying a distinctly humanitarian goods approach to giving citizens the power to act out emergency thinking on a judicial stage. Yet we were told by a staunch public defender that patients who come to her seeking legal help are already badly damaged by the system. They come as car crashes with aggregated vulnerabilities that judicialization will not necessarily solve. Patients can often be trapped in an endless cycle of requesting new court injunctions, and as a result, treatments are interrupted, compromising adherence and health outcomes, what we've called judicialized disease. As health sectors grow within the realm of humanitarian assistance, a health rights approach is taking hold based on a notion of progressive realization of such rights. The Brazilian case shows that progress has come, but the goal of health has become highly individualized and hopeful, but also lacking in some respects. One approach that I find useful is following Lynn Friedman, to look at health systems not just as providers of care, but as incubators of broader political and social rights. And again, Sophia had mentioned this as well, showing how these systems in these very intimate relationships of caregiving can show pathways for patients to reach other sorts of rights, for patients to become citizens. How are norms and values about the equality of survival being signaled and enforced within highly interpersonal relationships of care and neglect in today's health systems? As health providers increasingly engage in humanitarian relief, we are reminded that these are the very institutions through which an equality of survival finds its most everyday powerful expression. So I have two questions. One has to do with health sector reform and how health sectors have become prime targets for reform, but how can we think about other political reforms in tandem with health sector reforms? What kinds of political reforms down to conditions of care can be signaled or enacted or enabled through changes in healthcare and changes in our understanding of the human right to health within health systems? And then also, while Peter lays bare the politics of emergency relief and Sophia lays the normative human rights ground rules to that relief, what does the aftermath of such intervening look like? What political possibilities are left over for further development or empowerment? So these questions, I think, point to the fact that care in a time of global health and humanitarian relief is a work in progress, but we have an opportunity here to shift the emphasis from disease to environments, as in the role of labor instability and violence in Chile and Clara's work, from trickle-down access or saving lives to inequality of survival, from populations to the singular and discontinuous experiences of unstable and changing regimes of hope. In such latter domains, how we define the right to health can either minimize or maximize the art of care, as well as the impact and durability of our human responses. Thank you.
Sophia, Peter, and Brianna for the wonderful presentation, inspiring and very related to what was, in fact, the main, the central issue of this whole seminar. And because the discussion here presented linked the role of the state, the role of social movements, the sometimes contradictory spaces and roles that these non-governmental agencies establish when they are supported by money that sometimes not there, and the that how you say this charges the
cartoons
presented was very expressive, and at the same time we have a very strong development of a normative reference in terms of human rights that enables us not only to go to law, to appeal to justice, to make some rights fulfilled, but also as a kind of a horizon, a guidelines to inspire that transformation that Adriana so well pointed out, that moving beyond the biomedical approach to care, to medicine, and also how also Sophia said that thinking health beyond access to health care. So thank you very much for this. Now we have the chance for us to debate more widely. Ms. Clara, then João.
So thanks for the papers. I just had a couple of questions and maybe comments. So the first one was Peter, just to note that so with the New York Times graphic on the Ebola outbreaks, where they showed a total number of cases. So I guess I was wondering if you could maybe elaborate a little bit on the form or of visualization of the graphic. Because what's actually stunning there is that it gives these pie charts or and numbers underneath the number of cases. So it's not just like 1 to 900, and in underneath it's like 3,433, this kind of thing, with that kind of precision, right? And these are actually countries where we know that health systems and surveillance largely do not exist. And so then it made me think about the World Health World Development Report 2012 that actually said that we can't actually make any claims as to what is happening on the ground in certain African countries because there are actually no studies. There is no empirical evidence. So I guess the question is, why is it that the form of visualization creates a kind of idea that we know what's going on, a certainty? And you know, how does that certainty, the kind of visualization of data that way allow for a kind of intervention? So that's the first question, comment. And the second I had for this, two I had for Sophia was, so you listed the people and you said, well, people need to be front and center people. So I guess I was wondering, and you know, we've talked some about rehumanization or rehumanizing care, but I guess my question is, what is the human here? Or what is being human? Because I can give multiple examples of actually how you know, being human would actually, in a certain corner of the human, you would lose your world if you lost the forest, for example. Like, that you wouldn't actually, that you, the human actually precisely emerges in that specific corner of the human in relation to animals, in relation to the plants, right? And so, in relation to spirits. So cutting down the tree may look like it's just a tree, but it's in fact actually the tree ancestor. And so you're actually cutting the life of the community. So I guess I was wondering why privilege a concept of the human, you know, that's just in an idea of a human being rather than like the relational ways in which people actually constitute their idea of being human. Right. So that's one. So then how would that actually shift this question of either health or care? And then the third is really to ask kind of it's a difficult question, but how do we understand, it's in a way, it seems to me easier to just accept that everybody takes health as a value in their lives, you know? And if we start from that starting point, if we continue with that presumption, we would then fight for that right to health. But like in my field work, especially around like questions of, for example, addiction, it's not necessarily that the people that one works with take health as the value. So then how do we actually think about care in relation to that? Would it just be a question of, do we just take the stance of paternalism? I mean, it's not like, these are open-ended questions, right? So it's not that I'm trying to like say, well, it wouldn't just lead to a question, well, then we should just deny it. You know, that would be a dumb response. But I'm just saying that that it does introduce this problem. You know, it's really hard, you know, of like what health isn't actually just taken for granted as the value that everybody desires, you know, so.
John, please.
So I'm collecting a series of questions.
Yes, I think.
Okay, great. So thank you so much. It was absolutely terrific. Sophia, I would like to hear your thoughts about what are you seeing happening, you know, on the ground with governments and organizations, if anything, under register of accountability in the field of global health and human rights. Is there anything new there? Because Richard Horton from The Lancet was here a couple of weeks ago, and he said that's the key point. There's no system of accountability. How do we engineer that? How do we put that together? How do we bring the various parties together? You know, so if you can tell us a little bit more, how would you envision that, and where is there some signs that something, you know, might be possible on the register of accountability? And for Peter, this was fantastic review of your work, and you know, and hear your thinking. And maybe if you could tell us a little bit, because we got some glimpses last night, of where you see humanitarianism going next. You know, with new technologies, science. You know, crossing new borders. You know, reaching to new frontiers via medical technology. You know.
Okay, we're gonna have one more question, then and again.
Thanks. Hi, Sophia. Nice to see you again. So I had a question for you. I was really interested in your point about the constellation of rights and how there are a wide variety of rights that are either under the umbrella of human right, the right to health, or simply related to the right to health. And I was wondering if you feel that there's any chafing between that conceptualization of health as a human right as something potentially a little bit wider than we might normally conceive of it, and your worry that there tends to be, or there can be, and it can be potentially problematic, that there's some diffuse language around the right to health, or there's a lack of focus in that kind of conversation. And so I'm wondering, like, how you find some sort of middle ground between opening up the conversation, but also keeping it focused in a way that we can feel like we're moving forward.
Maybe we can answer this question, then another round.
We'll go down the row. How's that?
Yes,
let's go down the row, but then next time we can get So I think that this question about the constellation of rights is incredibly important in terms of being able to keep the conversation out of just the delivery of medical services. And so I think it is incredibly important to be able to name them. And that gets to the next piece of that, which is that I think that the most important, and just to kind of shorten that, is that it's really important in the conversation amongst different actors that people are clear which rights they're talking about. And I actually, when I'm in a programmatic meeting, I actually don't mind actually asking that question, just because I want to make sure we're all on the same page about the ones we're doing. And I think that I've done a lot of writing recently about explicit use of rights versus implicit use of rights, and the idea that a lot of organizations feel that they use rights, and they call it implicit. And it's something that is very much about feeling rights inspired versus necessarily being hooked into something that would then allow for accountability. And so I think it's really important to name. So I'll just leave it at that for this, but to be continued. And that feeds into accountability, just very nice. I think that it really depends on how you define accountability. And I think that Richard is talking about accountability in terms of the larger systems and structures. And I think that there, I would agree that there's a mess, because I think there are so many different structures that are there. And the question about whether accountability is the fact of being something like in a court where something actually needs to be fixed, or whether accountability is actually about naming and shaming, where it is actually about kind of putting it into the media and having the media pay attention, whether accountability is actually about the person getting what it is that they require. I mean, there's a lot of different pieces of accountability to talk about. And I think that one of the issues for me is to be clear about within which domain are we discussing accountability. Because I think there are a lot of mechanisms that are functional that can be strengthened. And so, but I do think that at the global level, which is I think the level he's talking about, we have a lot of work to do. And I don't think I have anything to add particularly to there are the different commissions. I mean, you know, but I mean, those are, I think, well known. Is that okay? In terms of the kind of conceptual kind of questions, to be thinking about. I mean, I love those questions. I mean, I would say that the question around about the fear between paternalism and care, I mean, in that sense, in terms of how we think about that. You know, it's interesting because the lawyer in me starts with the state obligation. It starts with where is the system? And then it moves to the fact that the human has the ability to choose or reject what it is that's being offered, but I would hate to set up a system where it wasn't on offer. And so what I worry about with the conversation, not in an academic setting, but what I worry about the conversation in a pragmatic way, is that one ends up into a situation where, well, if those people aren't going to want what we offer, then we might as well not offer it because it's expensive, because it's this, because it's that. And so I find that what I would push on this is to be able to really privilege the notion of how it is that we ensure one of the key pieces of the delivery of services that I put up there but I didn't talk about at all is acceptability. And acceptability is to the user. And so one of the issues about the delivery of services in general is what is it that we do to know whether the services we deliver are acceptable to the person that we are delivering them to, and what mechanisms of accountability are there to make sure that that's in place. And I think it's a wishy-washy answer, and I think it's more of a discussion that we should be having, but I'm trying to kind of rush it. Yeah, did I do it? Okay.
Okay, thank you for those questions. First, starting with thinking about numbers and the portrayal. In the 1980s, MSF started its own epidemiological wing, offshoot, epicentre, precisely to generate information for them in settings where they did not have statistics they felt were reliable, both for internal use in a practical way, but then also to be able to represent whether a problem was a bad problem or not a bad problem. I mean, there's a way, and the reason I'm mentioning that is there's a way that the whole world of health is only legible if you have statistics. And if I were making that graphic, what I would really do would be compare things you can count, that's bodies in the United States, that if anything are overcounted, you know, excruciatingly overcounted and overrepresented, and then just a blob which says a lot of people. Because you know it's a lot of people, and you know they're of different orders. That's the point to really make. And I think the specificity which is attached to that blob is partly also a sign that of what is very scary about Ebola for health workers, for biomedicine, is that it's at the edge of therapeutic intervention. All you can do is provide supportive care, although good supportive care does seem to work fairly well. It does in contexts like the United States. If you have a whole army of people around you, you know, rehydrating you and keeping you going, if they get to you early, they've all lived. You know, I mean, it does seem that makes a difference. Again, statistically, it's a tiny little, who knows what's happening. There is no simple magic bullet cure. And it's not even something like cholera, which for MSF is a bread and butter disease. It was a terrible disease in the 19th century, but they feel very confident with cholera. They have a kit for it. They have a whole mode of responding. They have a kit for Ebola too, but it's not quite the same level of certainty. And I think the specificity of those numbers, or that model where you can slide the scale back and forth if you look at it online, you know, it makes you feel like you can control this thing. You know, if you only went back to May, let's just slide it back to May, and oh, look, you know, so many lives are saved. And I think part of that is also a desire to reproduce the narrative that we are in control of health. We know that we have the possibility to intervene and succeed and save lives. I mean, the model is important too, because in terms of the politics of health, yes, you know, why weren't there earlier interventions? And yes, you know, to some extent, I think that model is true, that it would have been much better had things been done much earlier. But it's your question, I think, gets to the heart of part of what is at stake here. I just want to just mention one thing with the human, which in the worlds where MSF is working, the human and the line of what is human and what is not human, that the non-human can also be something which humans are charged with at moments of very divisive interactions like genocide, your humanity will be taken away from you. And while the whole terrain of what is human, what is non-human is a tricky thing, it's contested, I do want to remember that as well, that the possibility of someone else being describing you as not being human, excluding you from a realm of humanity, can have consequences even as not recognizing the connections or relationality of the human with non-humans can have consequences. Health is a value, absolutely. And one of the things I think we struggle with now is to think about values beyond health and security, which we're obsessed with, those two things, as if you could have complete security in this life, as if such a thing were possible, or that health were all there is, because at the end of the day, all patients will die. You know, at the end of the day, we're all goners, you know? I mean, that's the story at the end of the line is always going to be the same. You don't know how you're gonna get there, but you do know that's where you're going. Accountability, I'll get to accountability in right a second. Where humanitarianism is going next, some of the trends of things which I see as being very interesting, and I'm trying to pursue a focus on technologies, on inventions, devices, little very, very clever innovations which are imagined in relation to a problem like lack of clean drinking water or lack of sanitation with huge statistics attached to it. You know, 2.6 billion people do not have a proper toilet. And so I come up with my little device which will be reinventing the toilet as a response. And I see that as being a very interesting intersection between moral desire, this particular moment of capitalism, this particular moment of a fetishization of the object, and the toilet should be reinvented. I mean, it's, you know, you can't just simply denounce it in that sense, that there are systems that we assume which you could not necessarily extend to the entire globe. You just could not extend the sort of infrastructure that we might take as being a norm in a society like Princeton to the entire globe. So then what do you do? So that I see as being very interesting. The other thing is the market, because there's very little faith in politics, even though we're all in this kind of setting calling for politics. There's very little faith in politics, so people are turning to the market, even though I personally don't have a great deal of faith in the market as a means of salvation, but that is one of the modes that increasingly I see as being central in this terrain, in the name of sustainability, in the name of getting away from the cycle of emergency funding and things like this to build another kind of system. So I think we should pay attention to it because it's a real phenomenon and it will have real effects in the world. And that just wouldn't say one thing about accountability and the constellation of rights, which I really like. I think we're at a moment of trying to find proxy terms for talking about politics, because you can't simply say we need to change the world politically, because that seems to have no purchase. It doesn't get you very far. So what are the other languages, what are the other terms that we can use to signal politics without necessarily directly announcing it?
I just wanted to pick up on the accountability issue again and just ask you, because of you being a lawyer, constitutional right to health is guaranteed, I think, by over 100 constitutions around the world. And we've said that accountability is very important. And so what kind of different varieties of accountability do you see within the landscape of the human right to health? I mean, you mentioned the evidence-based medicine, the evidence-based dimension of the human right to health, but on a kind of systemic level within states, what do you see working in terms of systems of accountability? Where do you think they need to be most in order to, you know, ensure such rights? But I'm interested in what you see as a success story in terms of accountability, because I think we want to find those and work with them as well.
Can get more questions, you then you too.
I have one.
Yes. I guess I want to keep pushing on the question of accountability as well, on popular terms. You mentioned when you were talking about accountability that it is not a right, it's because it is a standard. And I would like an explanation of what you mean by that distinction. Because it seems to me that a right without some standard, without implication of some standard, is so broad that it's meaningless. right? It becomes a teacher problem, right? So just maybe some clarification of what's coming up.
Thank you. So one thing I thought was really compelling and came, actually out of Sophia's talk, but really goes across, was the language, I mean, not just of this constellation of rights, but of determinants of health. You got me rethinking about what those things mean. And I thought that sort of the language of determinants, if you look at each one of them, are so sort of prescribed. And I wonder if there's a way in which sort of what you're getting at within this constellation of rights could sort of invade the language of determinants. Is there a way to kind of get in there? Difficult project.
Yeah, this is a question for Peter. So when I think of care and kind of what that means in global health, it seems like a very sort of people-centered process. And this sort of language and motivation of life saved seems a very productive sort of process, which it's, in my experience in Sierra Leone, it is sort of practice by MSF, and I think sort of the Ebola example is a good one because the degree of care that you give a patient is correlated to the degree of risk you're willing to take on as a provider, both medically in terms of how advanced the care is, aggressive the care is, and also sort of more psychologically and your willingness to touch patients and be with them for long amounts of time. And I think within at least within Sierra Leone, MSF is quite conservative, and the standard of care they're providing is very, very low. It's essentially just sort of isolation. And so I'm kind of wondering, I guess the question would be, do people within the organization talk about this idea of care, or is it sort of avoided by this, or skirted by this idea of lives as somehow sort of object? Motive, if that makes sense.
Last one.
I find very interesting the presentation and also the Adriana's comment. And I would like to ask, I see that in the global dimension, the idea of human rights is very important. But at the national level, at least in Brazil, I see that the idea of course, there is the idea of human rights, but also the idea that we must contemplate the particularity of each group, the elderly, the adolescents, the gays, the transgenic, and all that, to be universal, no? The universality needs to contemplate the particular of the specific group. So, in the global level, the idea, the statistical, I find it very interesting, and the media has an important role to create the action. But at national level, to guarantee the accountability and to take on the fight against paternalism, you need social movement. And I think that I have the feeling, that the state, to make public policy, has a double function, has to create social movement, and social movement has to define what are the demands, and at the same time, to have the demands to the public policy respond to them. So I would like you to ask Sophia if it makes sense for you, this idea that is double function of the state in creating the social movement, because they need the social movement to legitimize themselves, not the government. But the
okay, this is fun. Okay. wait, is there? Yeah. Okay. All right. So I'm trying to be. Okay. These are all of these. All right. So I'm going backwards again. So Brazil is such an interesting story because so much of who are in government came from social movements. And so I think that there's a question for me I do not trust any state to create a social movement. It makes me extremely uncomfortable to think of a state creating a social movement. What I feel comfortable with is a state allowing the space for social movements to exist and for ensuring that they support, they don't shut them down, that they don't whatever. But the creation, I think, has to come from the social movement itself. And so that's I think, a point of, but I strongly believe that the state has to support social movement. And again, why I think Brazil is so interesting is because there's been, more than in most countries that I'm aware of, a real flow back and forth between people in government who then come out and then rejoin social movements and then go back in. And so that relationship is something that I think is more unique than not. And so I want to be careful about extrapolating from that to kind of something more global in terms of how I think about it. So that's the short answer, but to be continued. In terms of the question around determinants and the language that's there, I mean, you know, I'm totally with you. I mean, it was interesting, you know, when Michael Marmot was doing the Global Commission on Social Determinants of Health, he did not want human rights part of that conversation. And there was a number of us who were really trying to push to have engagement of human rights within what they did within the commission. And so in some ways that there had been some joining and then they really separated in some really kind of strong ways. And I think in the last couple of years, again, I'm speaking now at the global level, there's been increasingly efforts to try to bring them together again. And so it's interesting because I totally support your point, and in fact think that, in fact, if you look at the determinants, there's a lot, the determinants, if you look at what's in the grouping, there is so much to be gained from adding what rights can offer. But I think that there have been, back to politics, there have been political resistances to that, which we can discuss, also pushed actually by this government. To be said, because the U.S. government not recognizing human rights and the right to health and having a strong political space in global, in within WHO and within global spaces was part of that, but not, that's not the only part of the story. In terms of just the very simple clarification around accountability, and I'm really glad you kind of called me out on that because I should have been clearer, the issue is that all of those rights are norms and all of those rights are rights that are legal claims. Accountability is a standard within human rights by which you make those rights real, but it's not that the accountability itself is a right. Okay, so that, and again, I'm happy to further go on about it, but it's essentially what we're trying to be very careful about these days is to clarify what is actually legally understood by governments to be a right and what is a standard that they have recognized and something that they have to work with. So it's the fact that the accountability is how you make those rights real.
But we don't want rights to be a fiction that exists in some fairy world, right? Like, I don't understand how you can separate right from accountability.
I'm in fact joining them. What I'm saying to you is that accountability is what makes each of those rights real. So it is, you
so
need to have, what?
So rights fundamentally are not real, we need to make them real.
Well, it depends if we're talking at a conceptual level or if we're talking in terms of actually what the standard is that countries have agreed to. And so I'm really trying to stay very much at a state system level. And so in terms of how states understand where their obligations are. They have an obligation, both nationally and internationally, to make those treaties that they have signed real. In order to do that, they are accountable. They're accountable through systems. That's all I'm trying to get at in terms of kind of making that distinction. And we can continue this later, because in terms of the question around the right to health and kind of a good example of around accountability. I mean, you know, it's an interesting one. Somebody, it may have been you, mentioned the constitutions. Did you mention, you mentioned the constitutions. And so South Africa is an interesting example because in South Africa, because the constitution has within it non-discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation, where in fact there is tremendous violence on the basis of sexual orientation within South Africa. There's also tremendous violence in Uganda and in Namibia. Now, a colleague of mine did a study and saw that, however, in South Africa, that is the only place where gay men can comfortably go to health services and be treated with a level of equality. Now, so what's interesting is that the Constitution can protect what happens within a service because there's accountability there. And so there's a piece there where it doesn't fix what's happening at the community level. So it's a question about, it's a wedge, it's the beginning, but it's not kind of the whole bit.
In terms of thinking about care and human relations versus saving lives, yes, saving lives is a very particular understanding of what a kind of relation would be, what a kind of interaction would be. It has a history, a longer history, which is also attached to things like saving souls, which is more comprehensive than saving lives. The notion of life is very attenuated, the biomedical notion of life that could be saved. Absolutely. The thing I would like to point out about this in terms of thinking about the medical emergency as well is that in emergency medicine, I can treat you without knowing your name, without knowing your language, without your being conscious. I mean, there are many things I can do for you. This is how we understand the emergency, which is, again, it's a very distanced kind of encounter. And ideally, at the end of that, I hand you over to your regular caretakers. You know, I'm simply there to deal with the fact that you were struck by a car and you're unconscious and you have major trauma, and so when I stabilize you and I move you on. That is my role in terms of specialty. And that is what, that's vision is out of which MSF comes. And that's why they have such a stress on the importance of mobility, say in contrast to those organizations which seek to have a longer term interaction with a stable concept of community. Because the whole notion of emergency is you don't know when it will happen, and you don't know where it will happen, and you have to be able to be mobile in order to respond. And you will save lives. But that's not necessarily doing anything about the larger constellation or environment in which people are living, or that larger concept of health. And yes, Ebola is a perfect place for looking at this because of the risk involved and because of security and because of a whole host of it's a perfect example of everything that is wrong in the world related to health at present in a condition that actually is not affecting very many people in the grand scale of statistics or the grand scale of accounting, and yet reveals, in a sense, the whole system, I would say. If you looked at something like MSF's projects with HIV/AIDS, they're very different. They're much more relational. They have a different temporality, they have a different kind of encounter, they have a different sense of care that's built into them. And one of the things I've learned from following this organization is that you have to specify what we're talking about, what type of problem, what its temporality is, what type of engagement is called for in response to it. And then the one thing I just wanted to say about accountability and standards, I find accountability a fascinating term at present because it translates to all, talking to people at MSF, they understand accountability. That's a term that they attach to and they're always berating themselves for not being accountable. That's a way in which they can recognize a failure. It's a term that works. But it's also, going back to the question of metrics, I mean, accountability in systems, accountability has built into it an implicit understanding that you are going to be able to measure something, you're going to be able to account, you're going to be able to calculate, you're going to be able to put things together. And that is a mode to seek in which you could frame a concept like responsibility, or you could frame the practical aspect of what we mean when we talk about politics, that someone could bear the cost of a certain action, could continue to contribute to a longer trajectory, say, of recovery, as opposed to saving lives. Recovery and saving lives would be quite different.
We are in time to finish, but we have two more questions, and then we're gonna...
I think, because see, we're ending at 10, the next session is starting at 10:15. Right. So could we keep the questions for next session? Would that be okay?
Okay.
Just because we have a short time for a conference, and we start exactly at 10:15. Because we have at noon we have the colloquium here, so
and we can talk in the
corridor. We can talk in the corridor. I apologize, but like keep the questions for next session. Okay.
Right. Thank you very much. Thank you.